Kind thanks go to Brilliant for sponsoring today's episode. Today, amongst other things, I'll explain to you how SpaceX is possibly already performing research in preparation for the Mars colony.
What about it? Go for launch.
We're go for launch. Let's light this candle.
Ignition sequence start.
My name is Felix and I am your host for today's episode of What About It. We did it! 100,000 subscribers on YouTube in 15 months, 10,000 followers on Twitter, we're official. To put this into perspective, there are a bit more than 30 million channels on YouTube with more than 10 subscribers right now, and only around 160,000 of them reached 100,000 subscribers. We're officially amongst them now. I designed the shirt I am wearing right now for the 10,000 subscriber milestone. That was almost exactly 1 year ago. I'm wearing it today to honor those who helped What About It in the past 12 months. Without you, this would have never been possible, and I am eternally grateful for every single subscriber, every viewer, and every like. You truly rock. The new shirt for 100K is already in our new merch store, and you can find it by clicking on this info card or the link in the description. By purchasing it, you support me and the team, and same as last time, the shirt will only be available for a limited amount of time. Of course, I'm going to do a 100K livestream sharing stories about why, giving you some behind the scenes facts, having a good time with you, and giving away three of our Why 100K shirts amongst those who tune in. The stream will be this Saturday at 6 p.m. UTC. It's already up on the channel and a link is in the description. I want as many of you to show up as humanly possible to be able to thank you in person, so set a reminder.
Okay, Google. Set a reminder for Saturday to watch the What About It live stream.
Mark it on your calendar and tell your friends you've got something important to do. Thank you again for making our dream come true. Here's to you. Here's to Team Space. Here's to What About It. And as always, there's been a lot going on in the space industry lately, so let's dive right in. Starship Updates. Episode 120, and we're still watching, still speculating, and still trying to stay informed about maybe the most important development in spaceflight since Apollo more than 50 years ago. SpaceX's Starship has all our attention right now, but what is all the fuss about? I meet many people in my daily life asking me what exactly I'm talking about on YouTube. Most of the time, after explaining to them what's going on in Boca Chica right now, many reply with words like, why are so many interested in this? Or what is this gonna change anyway? And I am pretty sure many of you are facing the same problem. You can consider yourself to be amongst a small group of people who already know about the implications. A steadily growing group, thanks to so many out there evangelizing the topic everywhere they can, but nonetheless a small group of those who know. Starships could be the key we're missing for over 50 years. When we landed on the moon, it was kind of a brute force approach. Throw billions at it and get a few very fortunate people to experience what it's like to not be close to Earth anymore. To stand on another celestial body. SpaceX's approach, though, is different. Elon Musk and his very talented team want to give this access to as many people as possible. They want to open up space for humanity. They even want to colonize Mars. No wonder we're interested, right? So let's see once again what's happened since our last update. All eyes right now are on serial number 7.1, the Starship 304L stainless steel test tank. It's being put through its paces by SpaceX right now to get more test data on the behavior of 304L stainless steel in Starship construction. It's a low-carbon variant of 304 stainless. Its welding properties are better and its material strength at cryogenic and very hot temperatures is superior to the until now utilized 301 alloy. SpaceX has been testing 7.1 for a few days now under cryogenic and room temperatures. So far, it's behaved very well, no ruptures or leaks. Then, on September 17th, SpaceX workers cut it loose from the thrust simulator test stand. It was welded in place so it wouldn't move at all while cryo tests were performed. After cutting it loose, it was lifted up and over to a small jig stand right between the flight test stand and the simulator stand. After placing it on top, workers welded it in place again. This is a sure sign for SpaceX wanting to go all in now. The next test performed on serial number 7.1 will be to failure, meaning that pressure will be raised to the point at which the tank gives in. Besides always being pretty spectacular, these final tests give SpaceX data on the limit of the test candidate. So this is the most important step. As of recording the episode, the test was not done yet, but with SpaceX's incredible speeds, it might have already happened. Check out my Twitter for the latest info. And as always, SpaceX is rather unpredictable when it comes to test dates. Right now, there are tests scheduled for Monday and Tuesday. If serial number 7.1 has already had its final test, these test dates might already be cancelled though. Or they might be used for something different. Something bigger.
Something bigger. It is big.
What you're looking at here is a picture done by Mary for NASAspaceflight.com, and it shows a very crowded mid-bay at the SpaceX Boca Chica Starship construction site. Right in the center is Starship serial number 8, the next big thing. The Starship to go to 20 kilometers with 3 Raptor engines for the first time. It's possibly going to be the first prototype to even perform the belly flop maneuver. The famous skydive, never tested. It will do the power slide swing to orient itself for landing and then hopefully land. Eric did an absolutely awesome job with his animation. Even Elon Musk approved of it for its accuracy. Musk also said that we should see orbital flights around Starship serial number 15. Incredible news and another testament of SpaceX's incredible development speeds. And serial number 8 has just received aerodynamic covers for its aft flaps, as you can see in Mary's picture. If SpaceX tests the tank section first though, it's likely that the flaps will be mounted after those cryogenic tests. It might also be though that SpaceX is feeling confident about the construction level. In this case, we might even see a fully built Starship roll out to the launch site, including nose cone and all the flaps. No matter if Starship serial number 8 craters or lands, SpaceX won't have to wait for long to do the next test. Right next to serial number 8, we can see serial number 9 sitting in the mid-bay, and progress here is fast as well. The middle section of the methane and oxygen tanks is already stacked, and we're only missing top dome and thrust section. The thrust section is already finished though, so stacking of serial number 9's tank section should only be a matter of days now. And as stated before on other episodes, SpaceX is entering an early mass production phase as well. This is likely Starship serial number 10's common dome segment to be placed in the middle of the tank section. According to Musk, serial number 10 is only 5 prototypes away from orbital flight if everything goes well. So what are we looking at? A super heavy early prototype next month. 20 kilometer flights in October, and if the speed doesn't slow down, orbital flights early next year. NOTAMs, announcements for pilots in the area, have already been filed for 20 kilometer flights between September 9th and October 31st. Development speed in Boca Chica seems exponential. It took SpaceX roughly 1 year from Starhopper to the first 150 meter Starship hop. Now it seems the next half year will almost certainly get Super Heavy and Starship to orbit. We're in for a treat for the next few months. Liked the update so far? Then click the like button, subscribe to the channel, and maybe even consider becoming a patron to give some vital support. Link is in the description. The team is working relentlessly to provide you with updates twice a week, thanks to SpaceX's mind-boggling speed, and with your support it will be much easier in the future. Thank you. SpaceX preparing for Mars in Florida. But what's next? What comes after the orbital flights? If you know what about it, you know I like to speculate. I always try to base my speculations on as many known facts as possible, but in my opinion, without speculation, figuring out what SpaceX will come up with next is almost impossible.
But not for me.
Remember this? The good old days, when we still had 2 Starship construction sites to look at. 2 teams racing each other, trying to find the better and faster way to build the first Starship prototypes. And it was too good to be true. SpaceX soon realized that managing 2 teams would be too much and not efficient, that spreading the butter too thin wouldn't be the right way to go. So the Citco site in Cocoa, Florida, as it was known back then, was closed late last year, and my scoop on the whole story left quite the mark. I learned a few lessons back then and had talks with SpaceX officials. Being a YouTuber and a journalist can sometimes be a nerve-wracking experience. But what about it? What's happened to the Citco site ever since, and what's SpaceX doing there now? There's a big goal behind SpaceX's endeavors of running the Starship prototype program. In the end, it's supposed to be our taxi to another world. Elon Musk wants to make us multiplanetary by building a colony on Mars. To be able to ferry colonists back to Earth, for whatever reason though, SpaceX will need fuel on Mars. Methane is hard to come by on Mars, though. There are traces of it in the atmosphere, but not nearly enough to easily fuel a Starship with it. So Musk has repeatedly stated that he intends to use the Saboteur process, a chemical reaction in which CO2 and hydrogen are turned into water and methane. Methane can be used to fuel the landed Starships for their return trip to Earth, and water can either be used for drinking or farming, or it can be split up again and turned into hydrogen and oxygen, which will also be needed for Starship fuel and to be able to breathe on Mars. Hydrogen can be stored as an energy supply while Mars is covered in sandstorms, which happens quite often and sometimes lasts for a long time. A simple system in theory, but nothing that's being done on a big scale right now, as there are easier and more energy efficient ways for producing methane on Earth. Now have a look at this. This video was recorded on September 9th and it shows the SpaceX Citco site in Florida. We can see the remnants of Starship Mark II still sitting in the open, but much more interestingly, there is something going on next to it. I've spent over a week analyzing the footage, which is why I am releasing it a bit late. Let's analyze the picture and see what we can put together, shall we? First of all, the steaming apparatus in the middle is a flash condenser. Julia Bergeron took a picture of it from the ground and it gives a very clear view. Thank you, Julia, you rock. It is a self-contained mobile evaporation system and it's normally used to get rid of wastewater from manufacturing. In this case, though, there seems to be no manufacturing around to justify any sort of apparatus this size. The system is able to evaporate up to 76,000 liters or 16,800 gallons of water per day. What else can we spot on the site? We have a roundabout 20,000 liter water tank. We have at least 4 double vacuum jacket cryogenic tanks. They are, of course, used to store some sort of cryogenic liquid. We have a rather large elongated tank in between 2 of the tents of unknown purpose. We also have a so-called frac tank trailer sitting behind the 2 larger tents. They are called frac tanks as they often supply fracturing liquids to oil and gas wells. These trailers store water, up to 90,000 liters or 20,000 gallons of water to be precise. That's a lot of water. At least the green trailer sitting between cryo tanks and flash unit maybe is another frac trailer. That makes it 180,000 liters of water. The green containers though could also be something different as there are power lines going into them. This is an electrolysis system. It splits up water into O2 and hydrogen. The hydrogen in return can be combined with CO2 to create, you know, methane and water. Let's look at the large elongated tank again. It has a heat pump next to it. A heat pump is used to cool gas. CO2 has the nasty habit of turning into a supercritical fluid above 31 degrees Celsius, which often is the case in Florida. So this could be an indicator for CO2 inside that tank. So we have loads of water. We split it into hydrogen and oxygen. We then use CO2 and the hydrogen to create methane and water. Saboteur. Again, this is highly speculative, but if it is correct, we could be looking at a field test for a 1 megawatt Saboteur assembly. 1 megawatt, as SpaceX would need to produce roughly 5 grams of methane per second at an input of around 274 kilowatts to be able to fuel a Starship for every Earth-Mars conjunction. In short, this assembly should be able to fuel a return trip every 26 months. Big thanks go to Forks and Germ Schmidt from my team and Brilliant for helping me through all the numbers. You rock! I hope I didn't completely leave you behind with my deep dive into chemistry going on in Florida. Sometimes it can be hard to get a quick grasp of what's going on and it's hard to find the right source for your learning. If you had trouble following me, today's sponsor might be the right choice for you. Brilliant is a problem-solving based website and app with a hands-on approach with over 60 interactive courses in math, science, and computer science. Brilliant helps you achieve your goals in STEM, starting with one small commitment to learning and building up to long-term challenge and growth. One of Brilliant's top courses is about chemistry. Here you can learn all about the substances of which matter is composed, the investigation of their properties and reactions, and the use of such reactions to form new substances can be incredibly interesting. The Saboteur process is just one of many processes that might shape our future. This is just one example of all the courses on Brilliant. Brilliant puzzles you, surprises you, and expands your understanding of the modern world. All of Brilliant's courses have storytelling, code writing, interactive challenges, and problems to solve. To learn things the brilliant way and at the same time support What About It, go to brilliant.org/whataboutit and sign up to try out over 60 interactive courses for free. And if you choose to get the premium subscription, the first 200 people to join through the link will get 20% off the annual premium subscription. Learn things the brilliant way. Links in the description. Today's YouTube member and Patreon shoutout goes to Alex Grandy, Benjamin Crooks, Aaron Scott, Scott Payne, Jack Schrammer, Chris Brangel, Sammy Oscuro, and many others. You rock! All these people give their support for something completely free, elevating the channel and the team behind it to a level otherwise unreachable. If you want to talk to the community and me on the Discord, get involved into making What About It, or just want to send some love, consider becoming a Patreon or YouTube member too. Thank you. The last words, as always, go to my team. 100,000 subscribers, something I'd have never been able to reach without you. Thank you for being part of my life. Thank you for supporting my wild dream. And thank you for living it together with me every day. You rock. The next test performed on Sirio number 7.1 will be. I love it. 100,000. But what about it? What's happened to this? But what about it? What about it, my man? 100K! Sparships. 180,000 liters of water. Makes it a lot of water. Oh my god. Germschmidt, this is the coolest name ever.